Greetings. So we're going to work on, in this little mini lecture, understanding Eastern cyclical religions and where they come from. And not just religions, but also philosophies. So let's start with, and we're going to stay on actually, the Indus Valley civilization that we talked about very briefly, or that you did or supposed to have read about. Indus Valley civilization is one of the four earliest river civilizations. It is in modern day Pakistan, and this civilization was a very large civilization and very complex along the Indus River. Now, the Indus Valley Civilization, if you remember from a previous conversation we have had, a previous lecture, the Indus Valley Civilization kind of was on a decline. At about the same time, a new group of people were coming into the area called Aryans. They were nomadic warriors. We talked about this when we were talking about power in a previous mini lecture. And when they came into the Indus Valley, the warriors, if you remember correctly, I know you've slept since the last mini lecture, but the warriors voted in the chief. And over a period of time, the Aryans decided they wanted to stay in the region that is now Pakistan and modern-day India, and they became the ancestors of people who are modern-day Indians. Now, they came and they brought with them their priests and their religion, and it is based on the Vedas. Their holy books are called the Vedas, V-E-D-A-S, a Vedic tradition. And over a period of time, as they settled in, their power structure changed from where the warriors, who were at the top of their social strata, became second in line to the priests, because the priests, the Brahmins, they started to invest, or they became the people to give the power to the priests, or the princes and the chieftains. So their social structure remains to this day in the 21st century the very same way as it started around, well, sometime between 1500 BCE to 500 BCE. So around 1,000 years, this structure changed from the warriors being on top to, and Brahmins being second, to Brahmins, who are the priests. They are the religious leaders of the community. They are to instruct you how to interpret the Vedic texts. So they're at the top of the social strata. Warriors are second, merchants are third, servants are fourth, and untouchables fifth. Now, some folks who look at the caste system, which is what this social structure is, that again is still very much practiced today in modern day India, that the untouchables are really not part of the caste system. I added them here so that we have a better understanding of how this cyclical process works. Once again, I'm going to put a disclaimer in here. We are really skipping stones along the surface of understanding this. But for the purposes of our course, you need to be able to at least recognize the differences in the way people think about their religious, their gods, and what their religious practices are. So, under the caste system, we have the religion that people practice by and large is called Hinduism. Hinduism, and this is a polytheistic religion. So Pali meaning many, theistic meaning gods, many gods. There are many gods in Hinduism. Different gods, of course, represent different aspects of humanity or feelings, emotions, behaviors, a variety of things. So in Hinduism, Hinduism is it holds together the caste system. It holds this caste system together. Now, I'm going to be doing this lecture kind of. I'm going to be writing on this as we speak. So there is a concept of reincarnation, right? Reincarnation. So birth, so it's a cycle of birth and death, rebirth, death, rebirth, death, etc., etc. This is called the Wheel of Dharma. The Wheel of Dharma. Now, the Wheel of Dharma is important for us to think about because we use a lot of words in the Western world that we think are pretty cool, and especially now that in the West we have yoga and mindful meditation, and we've brought them into our world, into our culture, and they're super hip and all that kind of stuff. But really, people have been practicing mindful meditation and practicing the principles of Dharma and Karma for thousands of years. And it's not so it's not hippity-dippity. It's really serious stuff. So you're on the Wheel of Dharma here in this in the concepts of Hinduism and reincarnation. Now, Dharma is what? Oopsie daisy, I'll put this up here so that you can see it in bigger letters. Dharma is what's expected. What's expected of you? What's expected? So it is justification. It's justification for the caste system. It's not ideological. It's a belief. So it's what's expected. There is no, in Dharma, there is no upward mobility, upward social, I should put social mobility in life. Dharma says it's what's expected. This is where you are. You're on one of these levels in the caste system, and you must just, this is your Dharma. Where you are here is your Dharma. And you have to live that for your life. You can't, in the course of your life, move and go from being a servant to a merchant or a merchant to a warrior. No, not in this life. No way. So there's no upward social mobility in life. You must wait for the next. Dharma is what's expected. Now, that brings us to karma. Because karma is your, it's the repercussions of following or not following your Dharma. So it's repercussions of following or not following your Dharma. Now, I'm going to remove Buddhism and Jainism here for a second. Okay, so what does this mean? Very simply, because we say the word karma. Ooh, you got bad karma with that. Yeah, you know, if you don't behave, ooh, that gives you good karma. Well, the concepts are kind of similar, but here's the dealio. Okay? So let's say you're born into an untouchable class. Well, the only way on the social strata is to go up or to stay where you are. So you have to believe in you have to say, I'm an untouchable. This is where I am. I have to be satisfied with that for the rest of my life. How do I get reincarnated to become a better, come up on this social structure? Well, it's my karma. How do I behave? Do I follow my dharma or do I not follow my dharma? Do I do what I'm supposed to do or do I fight against it? Now, this is practice today. So here's a little story that is a true story from one of my students. I had a student who was at a university and his roommate was from India. And his roommate never did anything with him. Him and the other guys that were all in the dorm together never did anything. And he thought this guy was a snob or maybe he was a jerk or, you know, why is he so aloof? What is wrong with him? And eventually they went up to him and said, hey, why isn't that you don't do stuff with us? And the truth was that he came from an untouchable class in India. And he did not believe he was allowed to mix and mingle with people who were not also untouchables. And so he was trying to practice his dharma and have good karma by not interacting with people who he believed were above his station so that he would be then lifted up to the next social strata. So this is for real. People really do look at this right now in the 21st century. So make no mistake about that. It's a very, that he even got to the United States, very interesting story behind that I am unaware of. But that the story this student told me was a huge window into how real people see their dharma and how they act on their karma. So the theory is that you practice your dharma. This is what's expected of you. You also make sure that your karma is following what the expectations are in the social strata, the dharma that you have. If you follow it, the repercussions is that you have upward mobility. After you die, you will have a rebirth, and you will be higher up on the social strata. If you don't follow it, you can stay. If you're untouchable, you can stay where you are. If you are Brahmin, you could scooch down. Servants could become untouchable or they could become merchants. It all just depends on how you behave. So in the first little mini video that we talked about purposes of religion, which is to keep order and also to help us understand what happens after death. In an Eastern religion like this is keeping order. This right here is keeping order. Okay, because death, what happens after death is that, you know, you are going up and down on this social structure. Now, of course, it is, you don't want to be on the wheel of Dharma forever, all right? This is not what you really want to do. You want to eventually get off the wheel of Dharma. Because you could be stuck on the wheel of Dharma for a long, 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 many lives, many lives. So how do you get off of, how do you get off of the wheel of Dharma? So the wheel of Dharma has also got a name called samsara, but how do you get off of the wheel of Dharma and what happens when you, like, what is it called when you finally reach the ultimate goal, which is being off of the wheel of Dharma, that is called moksha. And this is a release from the wheel of Dharma. Now, what are you releasing from the wheel of Dharma? You're releasing your jiva, or your soul from the wheel of Dharma. That's what you are releasing in moksha, is you're releasing it from the wheel of Dharma. Now, something I think that's pretty important here is, it's obvious, I would hope, maybe not, so I'm going to tell you, you don't come back as yourself, right? So what that your physical body is gone, right? So what remains? What is it that you are trying to get to the next level? Your jiva, your soul. Your soul is what's running on the wheel of Dharma. Your soul keeps reincarnation of the soul, okay? But when you reach moksha, what do you become? You become, and this is important, nothing. Nothing. You become one with the universe. There's nothing of you that is left. There's no personal identity. You are searching as you are on the wheel of Dharma. And you are being reincarnated over and over again. You're stuck in this wheel. When you are finally released from this wheel, you become nothing. There's no identity that you maintain, which is opposite, completely opposite, of that linear Western religion, where your view of what happens to you when you die is that you're still you. You don't know exactly what form you take. Maybe you take the same form of in life, but in like a spirit form. But you are you. Are you. Your identity remains the same. Totally not this way in Hinduism and in Eastern, in this particular Eastern cyclical idea. Buddhism is the same way. And Buddhism is a philosophy more than it is a religion. It's really only a religion in Tibet where it was synchronized with the local deity. Although Buddhism is really a very complex and it can be practiced in a very complex way. For our purposes, we're not going into that. But it is important that Buddhism is a practicing the philosophy of Buddhism can be practiced by people who are Hindu, or principles of Buddhism, or people who are part of the Western traditions, Western religions, because it is a philosophy. It is a pathway to salvation, if you want to call it that, in a Western religious purview, or you could say it is in here, it is the way that you get to moksha faster, or a more direct route to moksha, because it is the pathway of behaving, using good karma to help you get to nothing, get to moksha and become nothing. Really big difference between these two groups, Eastern religion and Western religion. Now, in China and in some other in tribal groups, a lot of times you might have a deity, but after death you become one with the ancestors. So we will talk about that in another video. But for now, I think this will do. And if you have any questions, by all means, give me a call. Oh, wait. Email me. There you go. I'll see you guys soon. Bye.